Talk Show.
Recorded live.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. We're back on again. Got Volume 3 of the Dick Act, 1902. There's a lot of stuff that's happening out here with our own system. Trying to pass gun laws. I'm here to let you know that the Dick Act has never been repealed, and it cannot be repealed. And that this guarantees you your right to any type of arm that you want. I didn't say weapons. I didn't say firearms. I said arms. Understand the word difference in phrasing of what we're talking about here. Because, ladies and gentlemen, this is very significant. Very significant of what we are running into an issue is that they cannot regulate what you and I own or what you and I have or however many. As long as you paid for them and you don't have to sit here and keep records because they already have the records whenever you bought them. And the bottom line is you can buy them off anybody, and that is how it works. I want to bring up some stuff. I'm going to sit here and I'm going to bring it up to you. The Dick Act of 1903, under House Resolution 11654, comes back in and starts out with the basis here. It puts a lot of restrictions on their side defense. The Dick Act of 1902, also known as the Efficiency of Militia Bill, H.R. 11654, June 28, 1902, invalidates all so-called gun control laws. It also divides the militia into three distinct separate entities. That 1968 gun law that got passed in 1968, this invalidates it. The three classes under H.R. 11654 provides for are the organized militia, henceforth known as the National Guard of the State, Territory, and District of Columbia, the unorganized militia, and the regular army. The militia encompasses every able-bodied male between the age of 18 and 45, but it does go up higher than that because you've got military officers higher than that, and it now comes into discrimination. All members of the unorganized militia are to have the absolute personal right to the Second Amendment to keep and bear arms of any type and as many as they can afford to buy. Don't say you have to have a receipt. You can afford to buy them, you're entitled. If it costs you a buck, costs you a penny, you're buying them, you can have them. The Dick Act of 1902 cannot be repealed. To do so would violate the bills of attainder and ex post facto laws, which be yet another gross violation of the United States Constitution and the Bill of Rights. The President of the United States has zero authority without violating the Constitution to call the National Guard to serve outside of the borders. That also gives him zero authorities to regulate the ability to own certain arms like AKs, ARs. He has no authority, and Biden don't have any authority to go out and say, well, we're going to ban. No, you don't have the right to ban these. You don't have that authority. This will violate the Constitution and violate the Bill of Attainders. But ladies and gentlemen, this law is in full force and effect. It has been since 1902. For those of you that wonder, it falls back under statute at large, under volume 32, under statute at large. It's public law 33. Chapter 196, under volume 33, volume 30, public law 33. Ladies and gentlemen, we have an absolute right to a Second Amendment. You do not have to have a gun permit. You do not have to have permission. Problem of it is, how many of you going to sit here and fight this? How many of you willing to stand up and stand your ground on this? This is just like a driver's license issue. ATF, whoops, is that another administrative agency, an ATF? Is this another administrative agency that's regulating your ability and to be able to own anything? Doesn't this fall back under the public law 148 stat 1 state of emergency, where they turn around and the president gave agencies the authority to regulate? Isn't ATF an agency? Aren't they trying to regulate you? Isn't it an administrative agent that's dragging you in? Isn't this supposed to be an administrative court? Aren't you supposed to be an employee? This regulation goes back on the police officers. It goes back on the sheriffs. It goes back on law enforcement. It does not come back in. Because remember what we said here. A well-regulated militia, National Guard, unorganized, and the military, it does not use the word law enforcement. It does not give law enforcement the right to carry anything. They're not militia. They're not supposed to be a military force, because that's not what they're calling them. They're calling them police department. They're calling law enforcement. They're not calling them military. They're not calling them militia. What authority does a police officer have to have an AR-15 fully automatic or anything else out here? What gives them the right to even carry a firearm? What allows them the right to carry a pistol? Stop and think about what I'm saying here, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not the one that wrote these laws and rules and regulations up. It goes right back in to their side. These are their public laws. They created it. There's nothing in the laws that give law enforcement the ability to pack any type of pistol, shotgun, or rifle, AR-15, or anything else. There's nothing in the regs that allows them to carry. They took it upon themselves. The lawyers gave it. The judges took it upon themselves to arm their own personal army against the civilian population in violation of the labor code. Think about what we're getting into here for a debate. Think about what we're getting in here for a argument with these people. These people don't have the right to come into your house and take your stuff out of your house. That is not within their regulations and not within their rights, and they are in violation of public law. they do not have the authority to come in and do. On Thursday, October 4th, 1917, Mr. Gordon, Mr. Speaker, on page 6840 of the Congressional Records of September 10th, 1917, the address of Charles E. Hughes delivered to an annual meeting in the American Bar Association is printed. In the address, Mr. Hughes says the militia within the means of these provisions of the Constitution is distinct from the Army of the United States. Remember always, said Daniel Webster, that the great principle of the Constitution on that subject is that the militia is the militia of the state and not of the general government. And thus being the militia of the states, there is no part of the Constitution worded with greater care and more scrupulous jealousy than that was granted when limited the powers of Congress over it. Mr. Hughes then continued, in order to execute the laws of the Union to suppress insurrection and rebellion, invasion, it would be necessary to employ regular troops or to employ the militia, and the power given to Congress with respect to militia was manifested to make a large standing army unnecessary. But as the service of the organized militia can only be required by the national government, for the limited purpose specified in the Constitution, it follows the Attorney General Wickerman advised President Taft that the organized militia, such as cannot be employed for offensive wartime outside of the limit of the United States. By his own admission and by the citing of Daniel Webster's and the opinion of the Attorney General Wickerman, Mr. Hughes effectively disproved and discredited the very points he attempted to establish, to wit, that the drafting of the militia, or any part of it, these men can be divested of the protection with the Constitution of the United States, throwing around them by limiting the use within the federal government, may make of the militia suppressing insurrection, rebellion, and invasion, and executing the laws of the United States. The militia, not police department, not law enforcement, the militia is supposed to be enforcing the laws of the United States. There's nothing in here that allows law enforcement. That now becomes a private army. That is private arming. And it is the militia that is to enforce the laws. I'm not saying it. It's right here in the paperwork. Right here in the paperwork. The militia was set up for accountability. The militia was set up for the labor code to come into these public offices to ensure that these people would not violate the people's rights. And if they did, they got caught. That militia, the commander of that militia, was supposed to take them out, and under the labor code was to execute them immediately. This isn't me saying it. This is what is written by their side. These are their written words, not yours and not mine. This was created by the Bar Association, which is the barristry, the lawyers, the Communist Party. They are the ones that wrote this up, not you and I. We are not supposed to have law enforcement. It's supposed to be militia out here enforcing it. And your police department are not militia, because they're under the control of the judges, not under the control of the military. The militia is in control of the adjutant general, not the local judge. Stop and think about what I'm telling you people out here. Comprehend what's being said. The term militia, as used in the Constitution of the United States, includes every able-bodied male citizen capable of bearing arms. And those have been further defined by the statutes of the United States enacted since the adoption of the Constitution, as all males captive of bearing arms between the age of 18 and 45. That was back at that time period. After the War of 1812 with England had been progressed by 2.5 years, and attempting was made to Congress to pass the bill authorizing the president to draft but lot the youth between age of 45 years of 100,000 men with whom he proposed the invasion of Canada, the enemy territory. But ladies and gentlemen, your law enforcement, is your militia, not your local police department, not your local sheriff department. Your law enforcement comes from militia, your unorganized militia, your National Guard. These are the ones who are supposed to be enforcing the laws of this country. And they don't come under the jurisdiction of the Bar Association, and they don't come under the jurisdiction of the local judge. That Dick Act of 1902 cannot be repealed. It invalidates all gun laws, including the 1968, including the bans on what they call assault rifles. There is no ban. And the sooner you people could understand the Dick Act, and it's like everything else, this falls back under an administrative agency, which is the president, that is trying to regulate your right to a Second Amendment. You have absolute authority to own whatever you want to own and own whatever, however much, as long as you're paying for them, and it doesn't give a dollar amount. It doesn't matter whether you traded for it. They can't come in, oh, you got 40 arms in here. You got 40 weapons, so we have to. You don't have the right to confiscate squat. Number one, you are a police department, and there is no authorization in the Constitution, and there is no authorization in the Militia Act that allows the law enforcement to be created. Now, this is something that none of you people ever gave any thought to. This is something you never sit down and gave one iota, but yet I'm sitting here broadcasting it out to you, and I'm reading the Congressional Records that come back in and backs this stuff up. There's no place out here that allows law enforcement. This is a private standing army created by the Bar Association. This comes up to the American people to determine what's right and what's wrong. Now, hold on a minute. But ladies and gentlemen, again, this isn't me saying it. We're going back into their own congressional records. We're going back into their own terminology. They cannot without violating the Second Amendment, bill of attainders, and ex pro facto laws back, they cannot disarm the American people. If you choose to give it up, that's your choice. And I realize a lot of you out here on so much of this stuff that's going on in this country, ladies and gentlemen, something you may have not gave any thought about is that this stuff may be set up through government sleeper cells where they have come in and they've created an incident. They have hypnotized people to come out at certain times to create an order to create a problem. It goes right back into wag that dog. Let's go create an issue, get something off the president. Let's go create an incident because there's more and more stuff coming out about this Connecticut issue. The problem of it is this. Our system has lied to us on everything. And if they was to start telling us the truth, we wouldn't be able to believe them anyhow because they've lied. But ladies and gentlemen, we're sitting on the documentation. I'm telling you where it's at, the 1902 Dick Act. We're sitting on the congressional records on all this, of what we're talking about. This one comes under. Let me pull it back up here. This is a whole file on the Dick Act that I have. That clearly comes back and shows they cannot disarm the American people. They don't have the authority. They don't have the right. They don't have anything that they could come back in and do to justify anything that they're doing. Okay, it was in the 1917 Congressional Record. Let me pull up the heading of this thing. Yep, Congressional Records on the Senate, September 10th, 1917. Starts out on 6836 and goes over to 6840. It talks about the 1902 Dick Act. This was done in 1917. But ladies and gentlemen, do not be played as a fool. Do not sit there and allow them to come in and regulate you on what you can have and what you cannot have and come in and raid, because this is a direct violation. And I'm going to remind you people of the word firearm. For those who have not heard this, I want you to look into Title 27 CFR. Title 27 CFR, Code of Federal Regulations. I want you to look under 479.11, definition of the word firearm. That is Title 27 CFR 479.11. I also want you to get into Title 26 USC Code 5845. A firearm is a modified shotgun of a barrel of 18 inches or less, overall length less than 26 inches. A modified rifle of a barrel of 18 inches or less than 26 inches. A fully automatic machine gun, and a silencer. These are what is classified as a firearm. Then they have other titles of destructive devices and rifles and pistols, but they have them separated for what they are. But the only thing that is listed as a firearm is four entities: a modified shotgun, modified rifle, fully automatic machine gun, and a silencer. These are your firearms. But you know what? The Dick Act 1902 blows that right out the window, because under the Dick Act, you can have these. Oops. You weren't supposed to know that. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been lied to, shanghaied, and bamboozled by the system so bad. by the Bar Association, by the lawyers. Your lawyers won't bring any of this stuff up. Your judges will suppress this. Because if this ever gets out and people really start understanding this like they would the bankruptcy of 1933 and that Federal Reserve Act of 1913, well, that the Federal Reserve notes are strictly internal, strictly for the banks alone, and you are not to have any of them in your pocket. If you really understood this and the system understood that you understood it, ladies and gentlemen, there would be an uprising in this country. There would be a civil war. There would not be a lawyer or a judge out here that would be in this country. If you people really, truly would start pulling your head out of your butt and understanding the simplicity and how simple this stuff really, truly is, and learn how to argue it and how to stand your ground, there is no place in any of these laws that allows the police department to even come back in effect. There's only one place, and it's in the Constitution, that dealt with the sheriff. But that is for prisons. That's for prisons. That's for protection in the courts. They don't have the arresting authority out here. They're to serve papers on you. But there's nothing out here that allows the police department to be formed. It is strictly militia that is supposed to be enforcing the laws. And that comes under the Adjutant General. Ladies and gentlemen, start getting a grasp of what we're talking about. Start getting a comprehension of what we're talking about. Start understanding their written regulations, their written laws, their written intent. Start understanding the significance. That Dick Act of 1902, ladies and gentlemen, this is the biggest thing that we have coming in as the private attorney general and bounty hunter. This is in the same significant area. Like I said, there's no place in the laws that we come across that allows for law enforcement. Your militia is supposed to be your law enforcement. You and I are militia. You and I are unorganized. You and I are the enforcement. Whoops, what did I sit here and tell you? You and I are the enforcement? You and I are militia. You and I are the unorganized. You and I are the enforcement. But we're not organized. Even though we're supposed to be unorganized, we're still not organized enough that we are the enforcement because we're still dealing with the Bar Association. We're still dealing with the judges and the lawyers. You and I are supposed to be the enforcement. You and I are the ones who are supposed to be sitting down, putting down insurrection and rebellion. And these judges and lawyers, they are insurrection and they are in rebellion. They have overthrown our government. They have overthrown our system. They have embezzled our name. They have embezzled everything off of us out of our account under the bankruptcy. They've stole our identity. They're doing human trafficking. What are you going to do about it? Ladies and gentlemen, we need to start getting a better understanding of what the laws are and how they're written and how they are to be applied. We need a better understanding. We need people to start joining forces and start standing up, and we need to start working together. We need to start backing one another the best we can. I'm giving you the best education. I'm telling you where this stuff is at. I'm trying to sit down and work with you people. I could be selling this stuff, but it isn't worth selling it. Donations, I'll take all the donations that I can get. Because it's my time with being involved here to help educate. For those that want to donate, it goes back to P.O. Box 435, High Shoals, H-I-G-H Shoals, S-H-O-A-L-S, High Shoals, North Carolina, 28077. Ladies and gentlemen, we need workshops up on this. We need workshops up on the DIC Act. We need workshops up on driver's licenses. We need workshops up on the state of emergency. We need workshops up on child support. We can't do this. Can't do this all in one. We have to break this thing down per topic to give you 2-3 days to comprehend. But if you can understand the state of emergency, you understand that 1913 Federal Reserve Act, and you understand the state of emergency where the president gave agencies the right to regulate, again, agencies, ATF, IRS, DOT, DMV, child services, your local county ordinances that come in for code enforcement. These are all agencies. Everything you're dealing with is an agency out of that state of emergency. Everything. You're not dealing with real people. You're dealing with an agency. And these judges don't want to admit this. Why? Because if you start understanding this, you've got them in fraud. Because you're not part of the administration. They can only regulate their own. They have no subject matter over the private citizen. These agencies were strictly for them and them alone. There's nothing in the DIC Act that allows law enforcement to have any type of weaponry on their hip, whether it's a pistol, whether it's a revolver, whether it's an AR, whether it's a shotgun. They are not entitled because there's nothing in the law enforcement in the DIC Act that allows them. It is strictly militia and militia only. That's your law enforcement, ladies and gentlemen. That's your law enforcement. Give it some thought about what we're talking about. Give it some thought. Because we got a lot of militia people out here. We got an awful lot of militia people. Go back and understand your role. Go back and understand your purpose, what your function is. Understand what your purpose and function. You're supposed to be in law enforcement. You have the authority for insurrection rebellion to put it down. And what are these lawyers, what are these judges doing? This is insurrection rebellion. What are these bankers doing? Insurrection and rebellion. They stole your identity. They stole your birth name. They're swindling your inheritance. They're swindling your trust. You want to fight these people? Get educated. Get knowledgeable. Understand what this stuff is. Learn how to come back in and apply it. Learn how to come back in and start getting organized. And start working in groups. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the third segment I did here today. The first one was on 1913, 1933 bankruptcy. The second one was on driver's licenses. This one's on the DIC Act of 1902. I'm trying to break these things down to hopefully give you a better understanding. Where with what you're looking at, you can go back and do a little bit of research and grasp what's being said. Ladies and gentlemen, I can only go so far. I can give you the information. You have to come back in and look it up yourself. You want to get some workshops up that I can bring it out and show you up on a screen, then you're going to have to get some workshops up. Otherwise, take what I'm giving you. Comprehend it. I've learned this stuff on the same manner as what I'm teaching you. I've learned how to go do my own research. I've got a research team behind me that's giving me a lot of information, but I still have to research their stuff. But ladies and gentlemen, the choice is yours. We're not trying to advocate anything here other than stick up for your rights. And don't allow them to violate their own rules and regulations, their own guidelines. And ladies and gentlemen, that is exactly what they're doing. They're violating their own statutory law when it comes down to you and I. They're depriving you and I of our rights under the Bill of Rights and under their own regulations that can only apply to them. So I've given you enough here and three calls here today for a basic understanding that everything that we're dealing with deals with agencies. It all comes out of that state of emergency under Section 2, that Public Law 148, Stat 1. Upon the banking issue or war or defense or state of emergency, the president can sit here and point to an agency to regulate. ATF, IRS, DOT, DMV, Child Services, all of this falls under the state of emergency. Comprehend this. Grasp it. Understand it. And the rest of this stuff will fall into place for you. The rest of it will go click, click, click. Fall right into place. Thank you. This is the third show for today. I'll set some more up for a later date where we can get into some other issues. But we did three here for you guys to get back into. Y'all have a good day and have a good night. And hope you had a good Christmas and have a good New Year. Bye-bye. Good New Year. Bye-bye. Good New Year. Bye-bye. Good New Year. Bye-bye. Good New Year. Bye-bye.
Have Rod on the phone, so let me put him on, and you can all go ahead.
Okay, Rod,
yeah,
you're there.
I apologize. I had one of the guys I was in court with today got thrown into court, got thrown into jail, and I had to go bail him out. So we're just now getting home.
That's standard procedure for people like us. That's all we seem to be doing. Bailing people out, going to court. I actually want to know, what's the latest with your court thing in Washington?
Well, I tell you what, Joe, Paula. A change of events happened up in D.C. Whenever I was going through the D.C. District Court for the trial, as by me coming in, Joe and Paula, nailing them, under their own rules, under their own procedure. That's the same thing that happened up here in Newton today. But in D.C., I brought in the prosecution's rules and their regulations. I brought in their language. And the only thing that the prosecutor came back with for a rebuttal, because the judge finally sat down and says, look, don't you think you ought to answer this man's paperwork, because he's got over 38 documents in here. The only thing that the United States Attorney's Office could come back with for a response is that they have no position and they take no stand. That was their argument.
Well, then what were you doing there if they have no position and no stand?
Well, that was the whole thing. Every time we tried to get into that, the judge kept shutting the hearing down. That was the whole thing. As I got to explain, and I got into the 1925 Statutes at Large, Volume 43. And it shows that it stopped on March 4th, 1925. Now, the dates are very, very, very important, because in Volume 44, it picked up on December 16th, 1925. So if you do the math from March 4th to December 16th, we got close to 8-9 months missing. Well, supposedly, on December 7th, 1925, the United States codes were passed under HB 10,000, supposedly. But when you go back and you look at the statutes at large for that December 7th, it does not appear. It does not show up. So we brought into the fact that the United States codes were never passed. And when I brought this up before the judge and I handed her the congressional records on this, this wasn't hearsay. I actually got it from the Library of Congress. I put it in as evidence. And she looked at the prosecutor and asked, could you rebut this man? And the only thing he could do was shake his head no to the answer. And then I went on to explain that in the Federal Registry of 1935 and the National Industrial Recovery Act of 1935, as that the Congress created an administrative commission and allowed the commission and the president to codify the statutes at large into administrative regulations and codes for the agencies. And I handed her, here's the paperwork, here's the documentation. Your United States codes that you're charging me with does not apply. Here's is the history that it was never passed. There's too many mistakes in it. The Senate never agreed to it. The Senate and Congress agreed to turn these into administrative guidelines for the administration. And she again looked at the prosecutor. She said, can you rebut him? And he dropped his head and she shut the hearing down again. I could never get a pass. All they could do is sit here and shake their head no. They could not rebut. That's why they could not take a position in this thing. They could not rebut my paperwork. So what ended up happening out of all this is it come down to the last days of this, and I tried some new paperwork that was given to me. And the paperwork was sound. It was sound paperwork. I went back in and I told the judge, because of what is going on here, I want an in-camera hearing. Or I want you to do a teleconference with me, because so far there's been no jurisdiction. You have nothing. And there's no sense in wasting court time. We could do this privately. Well, he got me for failure to appear. But the problem of it is, I was supposed to show up in court on October 27th, 2014. They came in and dropped and dismissed all my charges on October 23rd, 2014. 4 days before I was supposed to appear, they dropped and dismissed all my charges, and they did a brand new grand jury indictment under a new charge. And they got me for failure to appear in contempt for the charges being dropped.
Yeah, they don't play fair.
No, they don't, but that's fine. What we got into is that on my... Finally, we got to the arraignment side of this. Not arraignment, but the allocution side of this thing. But I got in onto the allocution, and the judge asked me if I agreed with the plea bargain that was done on the 16th. I said, well, no, I don't agree to it. I said, because your prosecutor lied to me. Your public defender lied to me. Your underling just ruled that the very thing that I'm charged with was declared unconstitutional. Supreme Court has ruled it unconstitutional. Massey out of Tennessee came in and defund the District of Columbia for the very problem that we're having right here. D.C.'s been defunded because of this. I said, so no, I don't agree to a plea agreement. I said it was fake and false on the start, beginning with. So he asked me, he says, okay, now for the elocution. He said, do you have anything to say for the elocution? I said, yes, I do. I said, your prosecutor made a comment on the record that he now hopes that Mr. Class would learn to follow the laws the way they are written. And I asked him, I said, would you like to tell me what laws that I violated? I said, I had a carry concealed permit from North Carolina that's supposed to be under full faith and credit under the Constitution. No matter where I go, it's full faith and credit. I said, I had my stuff registered with the FBI. So I met two of the qualifications. My stuff was registered, and I had a carry concealed permit. Now, let's go back and talk about the fact that your property wasn't posted. Under Title 18, Section 930, you were required to post signs on your property to make people aware that if they came on this property beyond this point, you're not allowed to have a firearm. Your laws are clear on this. I said, oh, that's right, I forgot. Because you and I just talked here a few days ago, and you admitted in court on record that the courts don't follow the law. You guys follow theories and concepts. Don't you remember putting that on the record for me? And he dropped his head. He says, I'm going to allow you to appeal everything. I'm going to allow you to appeal the plea agreement. I'm going to allow you to appeal my decision. So, and he said, Mr. Class, you're going to pay a $350 fine. I said, would you like to tell me how I'm going to pay with this, as we're not dealing with any money? He says, I will let you take this up with your probation officer, but I will tell you this, I will allow you to file for informal pauperis into the appeals court, as there is no money. So he allowed me to file informal pauperis. Matter of fact, he cut an order for it. For them to take me informal paupers. Because we went back and pushed the issue. Well, I got into the appeals court. I got paperwork filed in. When I left the court that day, I filed a notice of appeal. I got it in. Within 30 days, I had a brief. I had a 30-some page brief I put in. Prosecution never answered. They went 30 days, and they never answered it. I went back in and filed in a notice of non-compliance, first notice. I waited 15 days because they had 15 days to ask for an extension. They didn't ask for an extension. So after 15 days, I put in a second notice of non-compliance where I have defaulted them. And I went back and I reminded them, under the Miller versus United States of 1939, Miller won his appeal court decision. He had a right to carry, but the United States took it up to the United States Supreme Court. And see, that is what people are not aware of. He took it up to the United States Supreme Court, and Miller never showed up. So the United States won that gun case on a default, not because of argument, but because Miller never showed up. So I went back and I used that in my appeal court. Whereas the United States ruled in favor of the prosecution in the Miller case because Miller failed to show up, I now demand the same equal consideration as the prosecution has missed their deadline and they have no intentions of answering my paperwork. I want a ruling on a default. Well, appeals court said on it. So I went back and I filed a certiorari and a mandamus into the chief judge of the appeals court, filing a complaint of due process and negligence on his judges. It wasn't a few weeks later, I get a letter in the mail, and the appeal court judges hired an outside law firm for amicus curiae on my behalf not to represent me, but to go through my paperwork and see if they could find any flaws to keep the judges out of hot water. The amicus curiae attorneys, there was three of them that came out of Virginia area. This was a Fortune 500 law firm that came out, that's based out of Chicago, and they get law firms in every single state. This law firm that they hired three attorneys. One attorney was famous for doing impeachment on federal judges, because he impeached a federal judge. One of them was one that sat on the board of the Judiciary Committee for discipline and professional accountability. And the third one that they handed me wrote up law reviews based on corruption of the municipalities. These were the three attorneys that they handed me.
Wonderful.
They went through my paperwork, and they put in a 240-page brief. 80 pages of it was brief, and 170-something of it was joint appendix. They went back and showed where I made all of the proper arguments based on the carry concealed permit, based on Article 4, Section 1 and 2, full faith and credit, based on the fact of the laws of equal protection under the law, the 14th Amendment, equal protection under the law. They went back in and showed that I brought up the case laws on this. But they also went back in and they brought up where the prosecution screwed up every step of the way. And the judges screwed up every step of the way. They went back and pointed out, Mr. Class followed the rules. The Judge Kessler and Judge Roberts challenged Mr. Class on a Second Amendment issue. Mr. Class had all the right answers. They overruled his answers. The judges had to go back and remind the prosecution to answer my paperwork because they was not answering my paperwork, and I kept defaulting them. Failure to comply within 14 days. Failure to comply within 21 days. Failure to comply within 30 days. So I was racking them up between 14, 21, and 30. These were the schedules that they had, and I waited till like about 35 days, and I went back and started numbering 14, 21, and 30. I went back and showed where they wasn't doing their job right. What we have now is that this is before the appeals court. We had to have our brief in on November 23rd of here last year, on 2015. The prosecutor had to have theirs in by Christmas 2015. Well, they asked for a 45-day extension. That 45-day extension was based on my paperwork was so complex that they needed more time to address my paperwork because of the complexity of it. Not frivolous, not nonsensical, not unintelligible, the complexity. It was too complex for them to grasp. So they needed another 45 days. Well, they got their 45 days, but I went back in under Rule 27H and made the issue is that they could not get that extension without asking my permission, because Rule 27H says you had to get my consent. And they came back in with a comment, well, because Mr. Kloss is pro se, we didn't have to ask him. Excuse me, Rule 27 sits there and says, yes, you did. You didn't do it. I want them defaulted. Well, they didn't do it, but they asked for another 14 days. Again, they did not ask me. I went back in. We didn't have to have our brief in to the 7th of March, but they allowed it till the 17th of March of 2016, which is just here a few months ago. The amicus attorneys filed paperwork in, again, showing all of the errors created by the prosecution. This law firm was hired to tear my paperwork apart. They were hired to find all my errors and find my weaknesses in my paperwork, and they could not find any of it. Matter of fact, they upheld my paperwork. They brought up to where Mr. Classmate all these issues, but they went back and showed every single error that the prosecution made and that the court system made, and they made one sentence statement to the appeals court. They told them that they should vacate the indictment, remand it back down with an order to them to dismiss the indictment, period. Nothing more, nothing less. They were ordered to dismiss it. Well, from what I found out, on that was the 17th, on the 16th, Judge Roberts was asked to step down. My paperwork hit on the 17th by the amicus. On the 18th, Judge Roberts retired. He resigned.
Wonderful.
Now, whether it was due to my paperwork, according to the internet, there's other scandals going here. But we know how that plays out. They will make up stuff to cover their butt. But the fact that before the amicus attorneys filed paperwork in telling the appeals court that they need to vacate this and remand it back down and with an order and instructions on how to vacate this, and then he comes up no longer chief judge, he has been forced out. Is that a coincidence? Or what?
Don't sound like it to me.
Yep. So that's pretty much what's going up. That's pretty much what we're sitting on up there. Now, we do have a hearing, supposedly an oral hearing, on May 5th at 9:30 in the morning up there in the circuit court. I'm not sure what room it is yet, but it is at 9:30. We have an oral hearing going on. Now, I don't know how they're going to do an oral hearing with Judge Roberts being pulled off the bench.
Well, they have to put a replacement judge in.
Well, if they pulled the judge off the bench, then that sort of pretty much puts a hole in the prosecution.
But why didn't they go after the prosecutor, since it's obvious that the prosecutors violated the law?
Because the judge is the one that allowed it. The judge is the one that allowed it to continue. He should have stopped it. She should have just said, look, we're going to dismiss this thing. We're not going to allow you. You can't do your job right. The guy's hammering you on your rules, on your regulations. He's slamming you on the language, on your job description. We're going to put a stop to this. But he did not do it. So now, you know, he's the one that is being held accountable for their screw up. But you know, we don't know what happened to the other ones yet. They may not be there.
Rod, one time you said that a judge has to make an entry of appearance and also an exit properly, and that they can't just throw on different judges.
The prosecutor.
You know, that's not true with judges.
That's exactly right. There has to be a process. That's the same thing with prosecutors. Prosecutors have to sign in with an entry of appearance. They have to get permission. Ladies and gentlemen, I went through five federal judges. I went through five federal prosecutors. And the reason why I went through so many is that I was able to come back and Like I told people on my show, I do not know how to defend myself. I don't know the first thing on defending myself. I do know how to point out their errors. And every time it was before a judge and a prosecutor, I was able to go back and show the error of that prosecutor and that court, at which point that judge postponed the hearing. I went before another judge, Judge Sullivan. He dismissed my charges. He dismissed my charges. The public defender I had sit down and said, Your Honor, this is Mr. Klaff. He holds position as a private attorney general. He holds position as a constitutional bounty hunter through Congress. I had checked his credentials. They are legitimate. The judge says, Mr. Klaff, I want you to get your Jeep. I want you to get your property. I want you to get out of D.C., now, and don't ever come back. Well, that was in the Superior Court. That was two federal judges I got rid of. I got over into the District Court, and I had one of the judges there. I'm not going to use his name because he sits on the appeal board on this thing. But I went up before him, and he sat down and swore me in. He said, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, or help you God? I said, yes, I do. He said, well, Mr. Klass, you just swore an oath, so if you lie, this is perjury. And if you commit perjury, it's contempt of court, and I can put you in jail. I said, whoa, back up. I said, are you telling me that anybody who swears an oath, if they lie, it's perjury and it's contempt of court? He says, yes, it is. I says, does this apply to your side? He says, yes, it does. And that was the opening that I needed to point my finger at the prosecutor and show where he swore an oath to the Bar Association that he would not lie, misrepresent, mislead, misconstrue, put false information before the court under the bar rules, and the judge shut the hearing down, and I get rid of that prosecutor, and I get rid of that judge. So that was three judges I got rid of. I went before.
I love you, Rod.
I had her for a while. But when we got into the debate, I asked her up front in one of the hearings, right there towards the end. I asked her, who is the corpus stelicti? Who is the injured party? And, of course, she was making a joke out of it, and so was the prosecutor. They were making hee-hees and ha-has. Now, we just don't understand. Well, finally, she sat down and looked at me. She said, well, Mr. Klass, you violated the statutes. I said, what, are you telling me that the statute is the injured party? She says, yes. I said, do you really, truly want to tell me that? And she says, yes, you violated the statute. I says, okay, let's talk about the statutes that your prosecutor broke.
Let me jump in for a second. I would have said, then I want to put the statute on the stand because I have a right to cross-examine the witness against me.
Well, you can do that, but I didn't go that route.
Okay.
Because what I did is I told the judge, I says, now, if the statute is the injured party, let me show you what statute your prosecutor broke. I proceeded to explain under writ of habeas corpus, under Title 28, Section 2255, that if I could show this court a constitutional violation or a statutory violation, that this court would have to dismiss my charges and bring charges against the prosecutor. I proceeded to explain the constitutional side of this thing under Article 4, Section 1 and 2, Full Faith and Credit, 14th Amendment, Full Faith and Credit. I got into Title 42, 1981, Equal Protection Under the Law. I got into the fact that I had a carry concealed permit. I got into the case law. I said, now, let's get into Title 36 of the United States Code of Ceremonies under Chapter 705 under the Federal Bar Association. This man is a federal bar agent. Under 705.03, it sits here and says how he can be disqualified from holding his job. If he advocates the overthrow of the Constitution and advocates the overthrow of our government, which he has because he's not abiding by the Constitution and he's not abiding by the statutes, he has now advocated, he has now committed treason. He has violated the Smith Act of 1940 of being a communist and pushing anti-government into this courtroom. He violated Title 18, Chapter 115, 2385 of sedition, insurrection, rebellion, and treason. These are the statutes that your prosecutor broke. Why is this man not being put in handcuffs? She shut the hearing down and ran out of the courtroom, and that's when I got rid of her and got rid of that prosecutor. This is what I
want my audience to know why. This is why Rod Class is one of my favorite legal beagles. Go get him, Rod.
Okay. This is WIOFLP, Woodstock 104. Please continue.
Go ahead, Rod.
All right. We back on again?
Yeah.
All right. But, ladies and gentlemen, this is what I have taught. And for them to hire a Fortune 500 law firm to be amicus curiae. Now, I didn't hire them. These people did not volunteer because this was a gun issue. They were hired by the court. They were hired by the court to tear my paperwork apart and find my flaws in my paperwork. They could not find any flaws because I used their own rules. I used their own regulations. I used their job description. I used their own language. And I pulled all my information out of the statutes at large, which was the acts of Congress, because we went back and proved that the United States Code that is created by Westlaw Publication was never passed into law. It is just a publication. It is not a law book. It's a publication. And by going back and doing that to them, they really didn't have any avenue, and they cannot disprove any of my paperwork because I proved the fact that Westlaw was not law.
Let me jump in for a second, Rod.
More than a codification.
Is that ruling going to be in your court case so other people could use that when they go into court and say, according to the Rod Class case, the statutes at large, the statutes are no good?
Well, they sealed my paperwork because even the amicus curiae was not allowed in my files. They could not even get into my records. They
yeah,
went
that
on
should never be. How come when people win, they seal the file so other people can't use those cases?
That's exactly right. But the thing is, Joe, if you follow the same pattern that I followed, like this happened up here in Newton today. I went in and I showed where the court does not have criminal jurisdiction. I went back into their criminal rules of procedure for North Carolina. It's the same way in every state. I went in under their jurisdiction, and it says they have no jurisdiction. It says it is reserved for future codification, which means there is no jurisdiction, or the rules of criminal procedure does not have a section for jurisdiction. It's deliberately deleted out. There is no criminal proceedings in these courts. We got in here, the judge, I filed in for a limited power of attorney on behalf of my client. The judge and then went through my paperwork, they crapped. They would not allow me to represent him. They threw me out. So they scrapped all my paperwork. Well, this guy tried to come back in, and they found him guilty. I got him bailed out. But now we're going to go file charges against the judge and against the prosecutor because what they're trying to come back and say, and they do it in every single state, you have to have a bar license in order to practice law. Well, I pulled up the correct phrasing out of the North Carolina statutes, and it's under Chapter 84, and under 84.2, disqualifications. And what it says here and says is that a magistrate, a justice of the peace, a judge, a DA, assistant DA, a public defender, a clerk of court, a sheriff, any deputies, anything that is tied into the court is barred from practicing law. The barred. It doesn't say Rod Class was barred. It doesn't say that Joe and Paul is barred. It says they are barred from practicing law.
Let me
They're
jump in again for a second. The Supreme Court also ruled, I don't remember the case, but I've definitely read the case, that the practice of law is a common right.
Exactly right. It is. And so what we're getting ready to do here in North Carolina, we have what is known as the Standard Judicial Committee. This committee is for you to bring forth a complaint against a judge or a prosecutor and bring them up on charges. Now, what's going to happen here is like everything else. They're going to come back in and they're going to say that they're not going to get involved, which is exactly what I want them to sit back and say. Because when they do that, they have waived the immunity of these public officials. They now can be brought before the administrative court, have a charge placed against them on the administrative court, get the administrative court to rule that they're not public officials, take them to the judicial review to get them to admit it, and then the next step is the court of claims. Because once you get three entities that go back in and say they don't work here, they're not part of the system, now we can go back into the court of claims and we can bring charges against them for impersonation of a public office. That court of claims is our court, but you have to go through procedures in order to get them there. Too many people are going to be on this call tonight is going to want to go straight into the court of claims. We don't want to do the other three steps. We don't want to go get their bar association or their judicial system to say they're wrong. We don't want to take them to the administrative court. We don't want to take them to judicial review. That takes too much time. That's where the problem is. People don't want to take the time to do it right. And this is what I've learned throughout the years. We are taking our time, and we're doing them right, and we're setting them up. They're losing their immunities. All we got to do is go back and sue them properly, and we can go back and do this. But it takes, you know, it's something that I have been working on for quite a few years on getting the bugs worked out of this. What does it take to get this thing done? What's it take to go through and get all the bugs so I could sit here and just run them? And it's taken me time. I had to go through trial and error, but nobody else was out here doing this. I was. Now we've got it pretty much figured out that how we have to go back and do it. And this is where that standard form 95 comes in that Dwight may have talked about, that SF-95 form. This is the federal tort claim. That is your complaint. Not something that you just write down on a sheet of paper. This SF-95 is your complaint. And then what you add to it, that's the proper form for the complaint.
Yeah, I filed mine in your case, but unfortunately, all the green papers, the proof that I sent it was in Paula's apartment when we got evicted and it got lost. So I don't have proof that I sent it.
Oh, man. Well, I tell you what, there is no limitation, Joe, on starting over again.
Yeah, I intend to. Dwight's going to send me the paperwork again, and I'm going to fill it out and send it back in.
Yeah, because see, this is the beauty of this. There is no statute of limitation of going back in, of exposing the fraud, exposing the crime being committed, because this judge looked at me when he threw me out of the courtroom. My paperwork, he looked at my paperwork and he looked at me, and this man, he was on a phone call before my client got called up. We sat there all day. He's waiting for a phone call, and I can almost bet you it came from Raleigh on what to do with my paperwork. And they sit down and told him how to handle this, and that was a mistake.
But you know what, Rod? The fact that you put in the paperwork and the judge was informed of the law, yet he wouldn't let you do it, and then he found that this guy guilty anyway, shows that he knew what the proper law was. You informed him, and he chose to override it.
So now we'll go back and bring charges against him for dereliction of duty.
Wonderful.
You know, Joe, like I said, if we could get the people to get off of all these other avenues and go back in and understand that we have to understand their rules, their language, their job in the congressional statutes. Because that congressional statute is the real law. Because once we made that determination that the statutes at large was the real law in that courtroom and not the USC codes, this made a difference on hammering them. Because I got the federal judge, I got the prosecutor, and I got the public defender, and I got the judge on record. He admitted on record that they do not use law in the courtroom. They use theory and they use concept in a courtroom. They don't use law. It's all theories and concepts. And that's how we're being charged.
Yeah, it's bogus.
That's exactly right. I just cornered an attorney here just a couple weeks ago, a week and a half ago. I was with another client. I went in, and him and I had a conversation. I looked at him square in the eyes, and I shook his hand and thanked him for inviting us in, you know, for us to have a talk. I said, I want to ask you one question. He says, what's that? I said, I want to know what you were taught in law school. Was you taught law, or was you taught theory and concept? His mouth dropped, and he looked at me. And he says, well, I was taught some on IRS, but we mostly taught case law. I said, you're telling me that you were taught theory and concept? He says, yes. I said, you're telling me that these people lost their home over a theory? They lost their home over a theory. People are going to jail on a theory? Is that what you're telling me? He dropped his head between his legs, walked out. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not dealing with law in these courtrooms. These courtrooms have nothing to do with law at all. Matter of fact, they are lawless. And this is why we, the people, need to start bringing in their own procedures, which is what the United States Code is. That USC Code is their procedure. That's their guideline. That is like you going to McDonald's or going to Ford Motor Company and they hand you a policy book. When you're working for that company, these are your policies. These are your rules. These are your guidelines. Ladies and gentlemen, the United States Codes are their guidelines. They're not yours. They're not mine. They're theirs because the statutes at large, 1935, under the Federal Registry and the National Industrial Recovery Act, point blank says that the United States Code was made into administrative codes for the agencies and for the administration. It point blank tells you that.
Explain that a little better for my audience.
Beg pardon?
Explain that a little better for my audience.
Okay, what that means is this. Because the United States Code was never passed in 1925, main reason was there were so many errors in it that Congress did it, the Senate never agreed to it. So because the Senate never agreed to it, they were never passed. So because they was never passed, they had to do something with them. So in 1935, when they did the Federal Registry in order to put them on record, they went back and they sat down and said, because these are statutes, United States Codes, we are going to turn them into administration procedures. We're going to make them into administrative guidelines to hold the agencies accountable for their conduct. The National Industrial Recovery Act was the same thing. Now, you got to remember, in the 1930s, we was going through a heavy, heavy depression. There was no jobs. The federal government created all kinds of agencies, all kinds of government jobs. Whether they were for private contractors like Halliburton and Blackwater and some of these other ones. But they were creating all kinds of agencies. Well, they had to have rules and regulations and guidelines. So what they did is they took the codified statutes at large, and because they were not good enough for the people, they turned around and they used them for administrative purposes, for administrative regulations. So these turned out to be how the administration and how the agencies are to operate. These are their do's and don'ts. You follow me?
Yeah, and they're not for us, just to let the audience know.
Yeah, that's why it said that it was created for administration and agencies. That's what it says in the Federal Registry. It was created for agencies and administration. So it can't get much plainer than that, and you can't get it much simpler than that.
And let me just add to make it simple for the audience. And that means that they don't apply to us. So when they bring us into court and try to use these, if you use Rod's argument, you can say it doesn't apply to me, therefore you lack jurisdiction. Am I correct?
Well, you got to go into more than that. See, that's a shortcut, Joe. That's where the problem's coming in.
I'm trying to make it simple for the audience.
You have to get in, and you have to bring the laws in. Carry them, put them in your paperwork.
Right.
Carry them in. Get it on the record. Now, Your Honor, the laws don't apply to me, and I'm not saying that. Here is the legislative enactment that verifies exactly what I'm saying, is that they don't apply to me. Now, unless this man, the prosecutor, can rebut it, or the woman, the prosecutor, can rebut it, then it stands that it does not apply. They have to rebut Congress. And see, this is how you have to come in and argument. You just can't come in and say, well, it don't apply to me, and leave it at that. You have to put it into your filings, put it on the record. You have to walk in with the congressional records in your hand, and then you have to verbally say it on the record. To show it here. That's the work that's involved in this. There's no shortcuts. There's no shortcuts. This is like when we filed paperwork in down here to the court. We put the paperwork in. I got this kid out of a contempt charge. We filed the paperwork in. It showed under North Carolina Rules of Criminal Procedure, under Article 2, under 15A, 102 through 15A, 130, it says, reserved for future codification. We put it in writing. We cut and pasted the section of the rules, and it was verbally sent here and said, there's three things that had to be done. And they dismissed the contempt charges against him.
Wonderful.
See, there's no shortcut in this. You have to go through a process here.
Yeah, I understand that. I was just trying to help to explain it. You and I, you know, we do a lot of law, but a lot of the people that listen, we're talking over their heads. So I every now and then I just jump in just to try to simplify it so people can get an understanding. But
oh, yeah,
you,
I understand that.
I agree. They got to do their homework.
Yeah, because, ladies and gentlemen, what has got us into this trouble is shortcuts. The gentleman that I just went to court with today, I told him, read the paperwork. Understand the paperwork, because if they don't allow me to work with you, you have to be able to lay this stuff out. You have to be able to explain it. I don't care if you take 15 minutes a day, 20 minutes a day, you can take an hour, go back and read the paperwork. Understand the paperwork. Well, what happened is we got into court. That's when he decided to read the paperwork. That's not the time to start reading. This should have been done 3 weeks ago. Up till now, and then reading it in court is just a refresher, not the first time reading. And he held his ground to a certain extent, but what they were doing is they were testing him because they knew I was right. They were testing him to see if he could explain the paperwork. And when it come time, he stammered and he stuttered. And that's what hung him. He was not able to go in and say, Your Honor, this is a traffic issue here. Now, according to your rules under criminal rule procedure, under Article 2, 15A 102 through 15A 130, it says reserved for future codification. I would also like to bring to your attention, under Title 28 of the United States Code, under 547, which deals with the prosecutor, it shows that the prosecutor can only address civil actions. But I'm going to further tell you, under Title 28, under the jurisdiction of the district court, where the United States is the plaintiff in the courtroom, under 1345, it says that the plaintiff, being the United States or being a defendant, can only operate in a civil action only, not criminal, civil. It says civil in there. Don't say one word about criminal. But I also want to remind you, Your Honor, under Title 49, United States Code, under Chapter 149, which is Department of Transportation, under Secretary of State, it clearly sits here and says that I had to have an administrative hearing up front first before the judicial. Your Honor, I have not had my administrative hearing. Your prosecutor has skipped through this thing. You don't have jurisdiction. Joe, this is what he missed. That's what he should have said. It was all in the paperwork. All he had to do was read the paperwork. It was sitting right in front of him. Ladies and gentlemen, that's where the problem lies. We pull all out of their statutes, all out of their books, to show their error, to show what they did wrong. You cannot freeze. That's why I tell you, read this stuff ahead of time. That's why we do this stuff 3-4 weeks, a month, month and a half, 2 months ahead of time. Read it, study it, familiarize yourself with it, understand it, walk it, talk it. So if you get into that courtroom and something comes up to where I can't be there or somebody else can't be there, you can run this thing and you can run it. Even if you got the paperwork in front of you as a cheat sheet, use the cheat sheet to make your argument. And he froze. He went to jail. We got him out. But he froze. And that slight hesitation of freezing is what burned him. Now, you follow me, Joe?
Yeah, I follow you. I've been through it. Yeah, I follow you. I've been following you for years, Ron. I can't cite this stuff off the top of my head like you, but I understand it.
Yeah. But, you know, ladies and gentlemen, I realize this is a lot of work, but your freedom is worth a lot of work because we have lost so much, and it's going to, we have to work double or triple time in order to get our freedom back. And knowledge and understanding what their job description is, and the fact that it said here and said under Title 49, under Chapter 149, is that there had to be an administrative hearing, not a judicial hearing. It had to go through an administration. And they're not taking us through administration. They're taking us into these ragtag kangaroo courts. They're not running us through the proper channels. And there is a rebuttable issue because we're dealing with agencies. And if we're dealing with agencies, then we have to have administrative hearings. And they're not giving it to us. They are subverting that administrative hearing into a judicial review. Well, we are being found guilty without that administrative hearing to begin with.
You're fading out a bit, Rod.
Yeah, this is what we're walking into. This is what I ran into when I brought charges. I had to go through proper channels when I went after the police department, sheriff department, highway patrol, and other these other public agencies. I had to go through proper channels. I had to go through the proper administrative. once we went into the administrative court, once that administrative court made the ruling, and I did not like their decision, then I took it over to a judicial review court for administrative hearings. What they're doing, ladies and gentlemen, they're not following the proper procedure. They're not taking us into that administrative hearing. They're taking us straight into that judicial review where there is no paperwork on our side. The only thing that is sitting there is that ticket. Because you don't file paperwork in, your lawyer don't file paperwork in, and the only thing that that judicial review judge can make any rulings on is what is sitting before him, and that is that ticket. So he has to make a decision based on that ticket. This is why we're trying to get people to start filing paperwork in. Start bringing charges. Start bringing claims. Don't walk in there empty-handed. Because if you don't put something in to rebut it, then you have nothing. But this is why I'm trying to get people to understand. If you get stopped tonight while you're out, you're going down, you're going to get bread, you're going to get milk. You get stopped tonight. The moment you get home, your paperwork for an administrative court gets started tonight. You're going to file one for an administrative court to bring an administrative claim against an agency. And the second document you're going to do is a change of venue that you're going to put into that judicial court. Because that court isn't the proper court. You're changing the venue to an administrative. When you get your administrative hearing date, if you get it before you go to the judicial court, you get that date first, that judicial court has to dismiss your case. Has to. Because
Explain how to do an administrative hearing. Where? How do people find that court, or how do people go? Explain that to people.
Okay, an administrative court, ladies and gentlemen, is a court that deals with agencies. It's basically an in-house courtroom for public officials, okay? Whenever they have a problem with any of their employees, they take them to their own administrative court. We're not supposed to know about this. But that administrative court is normally sitting at your capital. It is called an Office of Administrative Hearings. It is called Administrative Court. It is called, play with the name here a little bit. But that administrative court basically has two functions. One, for them to bring each other into. But the main reason it is there is so you, John Q. Public, if you have a problem with any agency or any of their employees, like I'm having right now with a judge, prosecutor, and a state highway patrolman, I'm going to get paperwork up, and I'm going to start filing into the administrative side, bringing charges against these three. I'm going to start bringing charges against them. All right. If you got stopped and you would bring charges, and the charges have to be legitimate. You kind of go back and show where that police officer breached his procedure. You're showing procedural violations. This is why I'm telling you. You have to know their rules. You have to know their job. You have to know their job description. And if you would understand the rule books, get into their local rules, get into the federal rules, get into the civil rules, whether it is civil rules of procedure, criminal rules of procedure, rules of evidence, local rules of court, appellate rules. Ladies and gentlemen, these are their rules. The key word is rules. And what are rules? Rules are something they're supposed to go by. We know they don't, but that's not the point. The point is, if you do not point it out in errors of what they are doing and how they are doing it wrong, then you're not going to get anywhere. You can't walk in and say, well, they just didn't do their job. Your Honor, a According to the criminal rules procedure on the federal level, under 3, 4, and 5, it sits here and says, before this police officer stopped me out on the street, under criminal rules procedure 3, 4, and 5, it says, number one, he had to have a complaint. Number two, he had to have an affidavit. Number three, it had to go before a judge, either for a summons or a warrant. Now, under Rule 4, Your Honor, it sits here and says, probable cause. His probable cause was based on, did he have a complaint? Did he have an affidavit? Did he have a summons and a warrant from this court to stop me because I failed to stop at a stop sign? Did he have a complaint? No, he did not. That's the issue here. These are their rules. And see, this is what we miss out on. We're not going back in. All right? Rule 12 under criminal rules procedure. Mr. Class, I'm going to strike your paperwork. No, sir. You're under Rule 12, you cannot, because under Rule 12, I have the right to an appeal, and you cannot deface my paperwork. You cannot destroy my paperwork. You cannot strike my paperwork because you are denying me an appeal under Rule 12. Just that simple. That puts a stop to them throwing out your paperwork. Mr. Class, we're not going to allow you to bring the Constitution into this courtroom. I object, Your Honor. Under Rules of Evidence, under 402, it sits here and says, what is admissible? And it says the Constitution is admissible. It says the federal statutes are admissible. It says these rules are admissible. It says Supreme Court decisions are admissible. You cannot deny me the right to bring in the Constitution whenever your rules state that they are already admissible in this courtroom and you're supposed to abide by it. If you don't like 402, let's talk about 501, Rules of Evidence. You see what I'm saying, Joe? You have to come back in. When they say something, you have to point to the rules of what they're breaking and how they're breaking it.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm glad that my audience is hearing it, and I'm hoping that they understand it.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is why it is so significant that we have to go back in and understand their procedural side. Because here in North Carolina, and same thing in Kentucky and several other states, I've had several people come back and do this. Their prosecutor came back and said, well, the statutes for our state says we have criminal jurisdiction pursuant to the criminal rules of procedure. Now, what did I sit here and say? They said that the statutes gave them criminal jurisdiction pursuant to the criminal rules of procedure. Excuse me, Your Honor. Your rule book here says it's reserved for future codification. So even though your statute may say you have criminal jurisdiction, it's referring you back to your criminal rules. And your criminal rules sit down and say you don't have it. So what does that do to their statute?
Makes them null and void.
That's exactly right. These are the details that when we start reading this stuff, we need to get into this type of detail and point out this kind of detail of defending what we know is right. Because when you're pointing out, you're no longer defending yourself. You are now pointing out and you're making them defend theirself to something they cannot defend against. Because it's their black ink on white paper, it's their rules, their regulations, and they cannot go against it. And ladies and gentlemen, that is the biggest secret of walking into these courtrooms. It isn't walking in saying I'm a man on the land. It isn't walking in saying I'm not that all capital name. It is walking in and right off the bat show the errors that's being created in that courtroom. Are they going to like it? No, they are not. They're going to get real upset with you, okay? They're going to get real upset. The bottom line is, you got two choices here. either you can sit down and be sheep and be sheared, or you can start shearing them and take some of the hide off of them on what we're doing until we start. I got two books. I come home, I ordered the annotated, which is the big, heavy, thick book like the Black's Law Dictionary or Webster's Dictionary book. It's a big, heavy book. I went into court, and the judge called me up about the paperwork. I said, now, which set of books do you want to talk about? Do you want to talk about these that I just got from the Judiciary Committee over the Senate and House side for the criminal rules and rules of evidence, these two little thin paperback books? Or do you want to talk about this great big heavy annotated, which has all the case laws and has all the sightings of how the rules were created? Which one of these books do you want to talk about? And she looked at me and she pointed to the little books. I says, good. I want this big heavy book with all the rules and the history behind it. I want to put in as evidence. She said, well, we know the rules. I says, no, you don't, because if you knew the rules, you would dismiss this case, because what we've already done, I've showed you rule violation. Now I'm going to put the rules in. She shut the hearing down because I put the rule book in. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the means of handling these court systems. Is it rougher? Yes. But if you take the time and you go after this, and it's the same thing with IRS, because you can get into their codes and their statutes and the statutes at large, and you can get into the National Industrial Recovery Act, and it gets into there and it shows you how the IRS was created and for the function of all these public jobs. All these public jobs under that Industrial Recovery Act that they were creating were the people who had to pay the taxes, because these were government jobs. It did not, and was not intended for John Q. Public, because we were not accepting government pay from the Treasury. They were. This is why this is another important knowledge thing. If we go back and understand, we could go back and show, wait a minute, Your Honor, why am I being charged taxes? Because here is the statute at large under 1935, under the National Industrial Recovery Act. It gets in and lays out the IRS. It says it's only supposed to tax government jobs and anybody that is working under the government as private contractors or contractors. They are the ones who are required to pay taxes. Now, why am I working at McDonald's, IBM, GE, or working here at the radio station as an employee? Why am I paying taxes on something that is not a federal, state, municipality job? Why am I paying taxes? Ladies and gentlemen, the information is in the statutes at large of what we're talking about. These are where your arguments come in. Does it take time? Yes, it does. But if you, again, you want your freedom is based on how much effort are you willing to put into it. What is your freedom worth? What are you willing to do to keep your freedom? Is it more important to sit back and watch football, so soap opera, and have a good time? Or doing some studying here in the evenings, even if you put in 15, 20 minutes
a day,
just going back in. But the thing is, once you start getting into this, and once you start understanding, it's like the Federal Reserve Act under Title 12 and under Title 31, which is money and finances. If you get into the statutes at large, don't read the USC code book. Read the statutes at large, because what this gets into, what it explains, is that the Treasury Department, United States Treasury, they are using the collateral of the United States. All right, you are the collateral. They're using the collateral of the United States to go to the Federal Reserve, and this is what it says in the statutes at large. They go to the Federal Reserve to borrow credit. They're not borrowing money. They're not borrowing gold. They're not borrowing silver or platinum. It says they are borrowing credit. They're borrowing credit. When you go to the, from the Treasury down to the Comptroller currency, which is the one who finances the banking systems across the country, that Comptroller currency gives credit to the banking system because they got credit off of the Treasury Department, which they got off of the Federal Reserve. Up to this point, there's still no money. It's credit. When you, John Q. Plummet, go into the banking system and you borrow, you're not borrowing money because they were never given money. They were given credit. And it says, when you sign your name on that bill or that note now becomes the collateral, not the house, not the car, and not the dog. That note became the collateral for whatever you borrowed. And that's what it says in the Federal Reserve side of the thing under statutes at large. But they don't put this in the United States Code because they don't want that information out. That's why you have to research the United States Code. Now, if you research the statutes at large, why you got to get into the statutes at large? If you will use the United States Code as a reference point, go down to the bottom, and you will see in blue, it ever have a public law number, and it will have a statute number. It would be like 63 stat 247, okay? You click on that. And that will take you over to the statutes at large, and you can compare the verbiage of what that statute said that under the United States Code compared to what it says in the statutes at large. But once you go over to the statutes at large, let's sit here and say that you're under Title 12. You're interested in Title 12. Get into Title 12 and you click on that statutes at large. That whole statutes at large that you are in will deal with everything that you will find in Title 12, which is banking. You will find the legislative language in that statutes at large. You will find more detail than it goes into in the United States Code. That's why the United States Codes are not law. They changed the verbiage. They left information out. And that's the same thing with Title 31. That's money and finances. Get into Title 31, United States Code. Go down to the bottom. Hit that statutes at large, and it will take you over to that whole section.
You got to talk louder, Rod.
Beg your pardon?
Talk
Rod, you're coming through very okay. weakly, yes.
If you will go into Title 31, which is money and finances in the United States Code, if you will click on that statute at large, that number, that 60 stat, whatever number is down there for stat, it will take you over to the complete set of what that Title 31 is all about. It's like 200-some pages. You can go through this thing, and you can prove every single mortgage fraud. You can prove the IRS fraud. You can prove credit card fraud because you're going back in and you're showing, and you can subpoena the Treasury Department into any court case, and you can point blank ask them, what are you using? Are you using money? Are you using credit? And you can bring out the congressional records here. It sits here and says that you are borrowing credit. So is this not what this country is operating under? He's going to have to say yes. So is there any way, if we're borrowing credit, that we can pay our bills on our home and on our cars and all this? Is there any way to pay it? He's going to have to tell you no, because there's no money. It's all credit. Your signature, right here, it says, my signature is the collateral. Does this mean when I bought my home, bought my apartment, bought my car, the moment I signed that note, I signed that agreement, that this stuff was paid for automatically? Because this is what it sits here and says, my signature is the collateral. You realize what, if people would start going back in and understanding the statutes at large on everything that we're dealing with and really do the research, you realize what we could do to the system?
Yeah, let me jump in for a second, Rod, just to clarify something for the audience again.
Okay.
All that paper that you have in your pocket that they call dollar bills is really not money. It's credit. They're debt notes. You want to elaborate on that, Rod?
Yeah, okay. 1933, 1932, Congressman McFadden on the floor of Congress stated on the record that the Federal Reserve note, that green piece of paper that you people have, and some of you, you don't have a clue, because I've asked people, do you have Federal Reserve notes? And they look at you. And then when I show them that says Federal Reserve note across the 1, the 5, the 10, the 20, then they realize. But McFadden sat here and stated on the record, on the floor, that that Federal Reserve note is not money. It is a mere promise to pay you someday. A mere promise. You're not being paid today. You're not going to be paid tomorrow. But someday in the future, you will be paid, but not now. So we are handling you a Federal Reserve note as an IOU, as a promise someday that we will settle up with you. And the thing of it is, ladies and gentlemen, it lays it out. And McFadden even lays out the fact that your signature, when it is given, it goes to the Federal Reserve. That signature is the collateral. That is also in McFadden's speech. See, this is the beauty of all this stuff, ladies and gentlemen. Everything that I have talked about, I can pull it out of congressional records, and I can show you exactly where it is. I've had FBI, I've had U.S. Marshals, I've had federal agents that have come to me, and I have sat down with them with my computer. I have opened this stuff up. I have went back to the 1935 Social Security Act under Title V, under Section 501 and 502. I sit back and showed in 1935 that the government put a $1.8 million price tag on you the moment you were born, and that $1 million each fiscal year that you live, the state receives on your behalf, but they're supposed to be using it to discharge your debt. They're supposed to be using it to pay off your bills. I had an FBI agent come out of Washington, D.C. when I was at a meeting, and she asked me about it. And I sat down, and I opened it up, and we had the meeting. I said, I want you to read this in front of this group. And she read that 1935 Social Security Act, and it sits here and showed where the state receives $20,000 in one section, and then in the next section it receives $980,000. And if you add the two together, that's $1 million for each live birth. And that was with a S on the birth, plural, each. That don't mean, it didn't mean all together. The word each means individually and single. You are worth $1 million each fiscal year. And this is what the courts and the system is embezzling. That is when you go down to the bank. That's why your signature has worth, because that signature is based on that credit line that they put on you at the day that you were born. That's why that signature, that's why the house is not the collateral. That signature was the collateral. That signature was the money to get into your account to discharge. That house was never supposed to be taken. And the reason why they're taking the houses, and the reason why they're doing the stuff with the Federal Reserve Note that they're doing, is to run a scam, because there's only so much land. And you people in New York, look how busy you are. Look how tight you are. You know, if they stole Paula and Joe's apartment, they put somebody else in it. Give them time. They'll kick these people out. Then they'll put somebody else in it. You only have so much land, and you got more people. So they could do a lucrative business by getting you to sign an agreement, take your signature, steal it, kick you out, put somebody else in it, get their signature, sell it, kick them out, get somebody else's signature, all on the same piece of property. You realize the scam that's being ran on the American people. That Federal Reserve note, like Joe said, it's not money. It tells you that in the Congressional Record. It tells you that under the Federal Reserve Act. It says that Federal Reserve note is for only Federal Reserve agents and for the banking system. And again, if you got into the National Industrial Recovery Act and you start reading this, it shows that those Federal Reserve notes were only for public officials. Because this was the means of them being able to keep account of what they have earned in taxpayers' money, so they would have to pay taxes on it. It was never designed for you and I. Again, this is the value of the statutes at large, people. The information that's in this thing, you're not going to find it in the USC codes or the CFR. The statutes at large has all this stuff in it. That's why it is significant to understand it.
Rod, before we only got a couple minutes left, but before we leave, how can I get a set of the annotated codes? I've been trying to find them. How can I get a set?
You can order them. You can get a disc. They do have a disc out with them.
Can you send me the address of where I would order them from and how much it costs?
Off the internet, put in United States annotated PDFs. And I came up with a whole volume, 1 through 50, all in PDF, and they're annotated.
How much are they?
They've taken them off the air by now. But that's why I got some. But I also had, you know, you can order a disc, and you can get the disc with that on there.
Yeah, and how much is that? Because I really need a set.
Oh, man, Joe, that stuff, some of it is anywhere from $600 to $1,000. Depending on where you get it at, or more.
I don't have that kind of money.
Yeah.
Public library should have.
It's not cheap. Now, if you get the books, if you get the hardback books, you're talking thousands of dollars.
Yeah, did you get the CDs?
With one, you're talking anywhere from $600 to maybe $1,000.
Did you get the annotated on disc?
Yep.
Could you send me a copy, or if you send them to me, I'll make a copy and send them back to you?
I got them on a thumb drive. I'll have to send them down to you.
Yeah, if you would. Boy, I would love it. Thank you. I really need them.
But the other thing, Joe, which you can get in, you get into that Cornell, law on the internet, and it has footnotes. You hit the law section, you hit the notes, and it takes you down to the history. And then you have all the stuff for the statutes at large. All you got to do is go and click on all that. That's how I've been finding so much of my stuff. It's right there in front of us.
Is it Cornell Law School under Library?
Yeah, look under it. Punch in United States Code, annotated, and it will come up like Cornell Law.
Okay, everybody, if I can just take a quick break right here and say that we are going to lose the TV station at this time. So if you want to continue hearing the conversation, tune your FM radio to 104.1 on your FM dial. That's Woodstock 104. So good night to Public Access TV, Channel 23. And now it's time for the carousel. It is The Witching Hour at midnight in Woodstock at WIOFLP, Woodstock 104. It is Pot Talk with Joe Barton and Paula Gloria and Rod Class. Back to you.
Okay Rod. Yeah, we were just saying goodnight to the... We go out on television and radio, so we just lost the television station, but the radio, we can keep going if you want to.
Well, I can go for a little bit. I've been going all day, Joe, and Sharon's... She's at a place where she needs help here, and I have been going all day, so I can't stay on here too long.
Okay, well, we could say goodnight, because Paula has some stuff that she wants to read.
Raja.
And some stuff from Raja that she wants to read, so we could say goodnight, and I'll be in touch with you sometime during the week.
Okay, but the final thing, if you will get into your internet on the United States Annotated, you'll get into Cornell Law. Pull it up, and you'll have the code, and you have notes, and you have what may be CFR. You can click on the notes or the CFR, which will give you more information. The notes will give you the public laws of when this stuff was created, how it was created. And if you click on one of the statutes or one of the public laws, it will actually take you into the statutes at large, and it will show you how that thing is supposed to be worded, if it's worded the same, the history of it.
Rod, I've pulled it up right now, and what I get is U.S. Code Table of Contents, and it's got it arranged in titles. Title 1, General Provisions. Title 2, the Congress.
Get into one of the codes. Get into one of the codes.
Any one of them?
Punch in Title 12, Banking.
Okay, and it goes in a different chapter, U.S. Code Title 12, Banks and Banking, the Comptroller of the Currency, it goes to chapter.
Okay, now click on any of those, and they'll have a number, and just keep clicking until you finally get into the main screen, because you got hundreds and hundreds of things on this thing. That's why it's so big.
Right, Federal Financing for Banks. Section 2281. Why don't you give me a favorite that you like to use?
When you get to one section where it finally just tells you what the laws are, it will have USC code, it will have notes, and it should have the CFR on it. It'll be the statute at large and the statute that supposedly created that code.
Right.
And once you get into that congressional record, get into that statute at large, then you are in a window here that you can start doing some research. But you can also pull up statutes at large. Punch it in. You can pull up statutes at large. It will give you volume 1 through 123. Put that in one section. When you go over to the United States Code and you punch in the statute, you look at the top. It will give you the year, the page, the history of it, the date. So the moment you get a year, 1955, you go over to the statutes at large, get into 1955, open it up, and look at what that page number is that you went through the USC code to get. You go over to the statutes at large and pull down to it, and then you'll have that same identical page. But you'll have that whole section of what you're dealing with.
Right.
And that statute's at large.
Well, I remember when you came up to the studios up here, you, on your laptop, you had a PowerPoint or you had it all organized. And it was so wonderful as an editor to actually see the scans that you did when you went down to D.C. and went in and scanned all of this. You actually see, you know, black on white. You know, how all these, you know, the actual congressional records.
Okay. I need to let you go, but yeah, like I said.
Thank
this,
you. This, Thank this you, Rod. Thanks
hard.
For calling in.
And we'll be in touch.
We'll be in touch.
Okay. Thank
okay,
you.
Bye.
You guys have a good night.
Bye.
Well, thank you.
Hey. Is Randy there?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, I'm here.
Anyone there?
Hi, I'm here.
Oh, okay. Right now, my computer's spinning, so let's see. Joe, do you have anything to say?
Oh, it's a disc. It's supposed to spin.
Yeah, right.
Well, that was all very fascinating. All I can say is I wish I had a lawyer or somebody to do paperwork like Rod Class does. Of course, I guess he's doing a lot more of interest to more people than I would be. But, you know, we all have our moments.